Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Towergate. It is Towergate Day number 568. 568. October the 5th, 2018. Friday. Thank you so much for tuning in. Okay, just quickly before I get to the news, update on the Kavanaugh hearings. It looks like, of course, Grassley had the cloture vote on, he had the formal deal where he goes to the Senate and tells the Senate president about the cloture vote. That would have been on Wednesday night. Then on Thursday, they did the other press conference. And then Friday, they're actually going to do, I guess, the cloture vote itself, which just means it closes debate. Senators will be given like 10 minutes to go up and babble. And essentially, that will be it. It'll essentially cut off debate. So then Saturday will actually be the day that they vote for Kavanaugh. It will be the final vote. There is some late word that there's a Republican senator from Montana who has to go to his daughter's wedding on Saturday, and he looks like he will not be in attendance. How that will affect the vote, I don't know. I don't think it will affect the vote. I think Kavanaugh is going to get at least 51 votes. But if it's a 50-50 tie, they can always bring in Pence to cast the tie-breaking vote. But I think that Manchin has given certain indications that he would vote. I think that Jeff the Flake is giving indications he would vote. Pretty sure Murkowski's given some indications she would vote that way. So Susan Collins. So I think that the three Republicans that were a problem before, I think that they're probably going to be good. Manchin's going to be good, I believe. So I think that the vote will pass on Saturday. I think Kavanaugh will get confirmed. I think he'll get at least 51 votes, maybe 52 or 53, notwithstanding the one Republican who apparently is not going to vote. But I think it's going to get done, and it'll finally be over, at least for getting Kavanaugh on the court. But as I titled yesterday's video, it's not going to end. They're not going to stop the attacks on Kavanaugh. They're not going to stop the attacks on the process that took place or anything else. The Democrats really don't know how to do anything else. They really have nothing else they can do. This is the only thing they can do is to try to fire up their base. And the only thing they can do to fire up their base is to continue to let their base believe that the Republicans pulled a fast one, that they cheated, that they didn't have a real investigation, that Kavanaugh's a bad guy, that all these sorts of things. That the Democrats just really cannot back off and have a sane, rational approach to anything that they do. Everything has to be completely unhinged and completely nuts, because that's what their base relates to and identifies with and associates with. So they have no choice but to keep playing the crazy card. And so I expect that they'll continue to do this all the way up until the midterm elections. They'll still be, on the day of the election, they'll still be talking about how the Republicans pulled some scam to get Kavanaugh on the court, and how we have to elect Democrats so that they can investigate Kavanaugh and overturn it and pull him off the court. And believe me, it's not going to stop. Just because Kavanaugh gets confirmed doesn't mean the Democrats are going to back off and accept, you know, that they lost, and that they lost the election, and elections have consequences, you know. So don't expect any change in behavior from the Democrats. But I do believe at this point, from what the word is, they will have the final vote on Saturday, and I believe that they will have the votes to pass Kavanaugh, and will at least ways have Kavanaugh on the court. Could do a whole lot worse. A whole lot worse. Okay, let's get into some other things that are been kind of going on the wayside for the past few days because of, you know, the Kavanaugh hearings. Probably the most important thing that's happened in the past couple days, 2 days, that is really not getting much news coverage because of Kavanaugh and everything else, is the fact that the committee that's doing the interviews of all these people from the Spygate stuff finally interviewed James Baker. He was, of course, the FBI general counsel. And he would have had a very close relationship with Comey. He was essentially would have been Comey's, would have been the guy who would give the legal advice to Comey. So he's essentially the legal counsel to the FBI director. He, of course, if you remember, was demoted, and then he quit. The general word is that he's, excuse me, is that he's turning on people. or giving up names or giving up information. Well, I don't know if all that's true, but we do know that after the interview, that Meadows and Jim Jordan did a press conference, and they were almost giddy, literally almost giddy. They said that they learned things that were extraordinary. They learned things, they confirmed a lot of things they suspected but couldn't prove or wasn't 100% sure of, that now they're 100% sure of. They say that after the interview with Baker, they now know there was a third source for the dossier. I actually pointed out five sources for the dossier. But they mean another inside guy, another guy directly going to the FBI with information. And we know who that is, by the way. Mark Meadows and Jim Jordan absolutely giddy over what they learned from this interview with Baker. He apparently answered all the questions. He had two lawyers with him, but he apparently answered a lot of the questions that they had and was pretty, I guess, candid. You get the feeling just from the interview I saw with Jordan and Meadows that they were giddy with what they learned from this interview. So let's just go through some of what's being reported that they learned from their interview with James Baker. So James Baker, the former FBI counsel, was interviewed. Jim Jordan says that they learned many new things. Baker revealed that Michael Sussman, S-U-S-S-M-A-N, who was representing the Clinton team, was feeding information to the FBI that was used against the Trump campaign. Sussman met with FBI counsel James Baker. He met with Baker in March and in April of 2016. Sussman turned on the DNC to CrowdStrike. He's the one who told the DNC after the so-called hacking, which we know is likely Seth Rich, but after the so-called hacking, he's the one who said, oh, we have to bring in CrowdStrike. Now, he has a good relationship with CrowdStrike because he was formerly worked for the Department of Justice, and his specialty was cybersecurity, and he's very good friends with the other cybersecurity guy over at CrowdStrike, who was an FBI cybersecurity expert himself. So you can see this this relationship between these two. And keep in mind that Sussman was working for Perkins Coie, which is the law firm that was hired by the Rotten Reverend Clinton and the DNC to represent them. And of course, we know they're the ones who brought in Confusion GPS and all the rest. So basically, now when you plug Sussman in, and keep in mind what we learned back in late 2015, which is, and we learned from Donna Brazile, that when the Rotten Reverend Clinton won the nomination, she had learned that the DNC was basically broke, that Obama had basically drained the DNC, and that the organization was a mess, and that they had no money, and they had a lot of debt. So we are told by Donna Brazile that the Rotten Reverend Clinton came in and said, okay, the DNC's a mess. You're broke. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to roll, you know, however much money it takes into the DNC to get your balance sheets, your budget to balance. And because I'm doing that, I'm going to take complete control over the DNC. So keep in mind, by the time that we got into late 2015, essentially, the Rotten Reverend Clinton was running the DNC. She was essentially running the DNC. Everyone was answering to the Rotten Reverend Clinton, and there's a tremendous amount of evidence to prove that is true. Not just Donna Brazile saying that, but much evidence that proves that that is true. The Rotten Reverend Clinton campaign and the DNC were one and the same by late fall of 2015. So when you think about the DNC and Perkins Coie, they're in the Rotten Reverend Clinton and her campaign, they're all one entity, really. I mean, they're all working really as one unit. You have the Rotten Reverend Clinton and her campaign, the DNC, and Perkins Coie. Perkins Coie is the law firm that represented both the Rotten Reverend Clinton and, of course, the DNC. And they were the ones that were being used as the middleman to bring in Confusion GPS to create the and manufacture the phony dirt on Trump. So this is a Clinton plot. It's, as I said, you go back to the very early Towergate videos, back from like the very beginning of Towergate videos. I said that when we get to the bottom of this plot, we're going to find the Rotten Reverend Clinton's fingerprints all over it. This was a Rotten Reverend Clinton operation. And so now, as we learn about this little jewel, it really, this puts a direct tie between the Rotten Reverend Clinton and the plot. And, more importantly, the Rotten Reverend Clinton basically having direct access, having a man essentially working for her. Remember, she's paying Perkins Coie. And this is the lawyer working for Perkins Coie, along with Mr. Elias, who's essentially working for the Rotten Reverend Clinton and the DNC. And now we learn that he is directly feeding information to the DOJ and the FBI. I mean, the only thing that's different here, I mean, this is like the Rotten Reverend Clinton herself going in to the DOJ and the FBI and giving them this information and saying, hey, I want a FISA warrant. Here, get me a FISA warrant. Oh, here, get a FISA warrant on Carter Page. Oh, here, spy in the Trump campaign. Here's the evidence. Oh, here's some dirt from Christopher Steele or from Jonathan Weiner or from so-and-so. The only thing that the Rotten Reverend Clinton did was she used a middleman, a launderer, several of launderers. Christopher Steele was operating as a launderer, laundering intelligence. She had Confusion GPS acting as the middleman, brokering the deal. So the money passed through them to, from the DNC and the Rotten Reverend Clinton campaign, passed through Perkins Coie to Confusion GPS so that the Rotten Reverend Clinton could say she's got plausible deniability. So basically, it's pretty much what I suspected all along, which is basically that the Clinton team hired Confusion GPS to manufacture dirt on Trump, to package it as a dossier, and deliver it to the FISA, deliver it to the FBI to get the FISA applications for the exploitation and essentially to get a FISA warrant to surveil the Trump campaign, to spy on the Trump campaign. It's essentially what we're looking at. I mean, it's just a very sort of elaborate scheme by the Rotten Reverend Clinton using various people as middlemen to launder things through the FBI and DOJ. But it's coming from her. If you think that Confusion GPS or Mark Elias or Mr. Sussman over at Perkins Coie were not in communication with Podesta and other people, remember, Mark Elias also represents Podesta. He was sitting right next to Podesta when Podesta was being interviewed by the same committee. And Podesta said, well, he didn't know anything about the dossier until afterwards, even though his lawyer, Mr. Elias, was the guy, along with Mr. Sussman from Perkins Coie, who were the ones who hired Confusion GPS to put together the dossier on the, I'm sure, direction of the Rotten Reverend Clinton. The Rotten Reverend was the director of this entire plot. She was directing the whole thing. Who was paying for it? She was. And to think that the Rotten Reverend Clinton's paying all this money and that she's just doesn't know what's going on, she just forks over $1 million and doesn't know what's going on is complete BS. That's not the Rotten Reverend Clinton we all know. I promise you, she was not only instrumental in orchestrating everything that was going on, probably created it, came up with the idea along with her and Podesta and some of her crooked friends sitting around figuring out how they could cheat Trump the same way they cheated Bernie. And we all know that the Rotten Reverend Clinton has a history of putting together dossiers. She put together a dossier on Bill Clinton back when he was governor of Arkansas and thinking about running for president. She wanted to see what the opposition was going to get on him. She thought, well, my husband, he's pretty dirty. I wonder what they're going to dig up on him. Oh, well, I guess the best way to find out is to hire a PI and have a dossier put together on my husband and see what we're going to have to be dealing with so we know who we have to go after before we even begin this process. Let's shut these people down and silence them before it even starts. And so she paid to have a dossier put together on her own husband. And you can bet she had one on Bernie. Better believe it. So Jordan and Meadows are saying that Baker is the most explosive witness to date. The most explosive witness to date. And they do expect that the transcript will be at some point made public. And that we're going to be shocked when we read the transcript of what they learned from James Baker. And the reason why he's key is because he would have known about everything. He was the general counsel to Comey, which means he would have been advised and kept in the loop about everything going on with the sources, these spies put in the campaign. He would have known about that. He would have known about everything happening with the McCabe stuff and everything with Peter Strzok. He would have known everything about the Wiener laptop. He would have been involved in every bit of this because he was the general counsel to Comey. So that's why his testimony is so valuable. And of course, learning now that Mr. Sussman was working for, of course, Perkins Coie and representing the Reverend Clinton, Rotten Reverend Clinton, and the DNC, was going directly to the FBI, where he has a lot of friends. He worked for the DOJ as a prosecutor. So he has lots of friends, knows lots of people there, probably knew Baker very well. So Sussman was meeting with FBI officials in the run-up to the Carter Page FISA application warrant. Okay, so he probably had a lot to do with the information that found its way into the FBI that helped them get the FISA warrant on Carter Page. He also met with the FBI, in regards to Trump-Russia collusion. So why would this Mr. Sussman, this attorney who works for Perkins Coie, representing the Rotten Reverend Clinton and the DNC, why would he be having personal, one-on-one, private meetings with the general counsel of the FBI? And who else would he have been in contact with? You think he would have been in contact with Glenn Simpson? Do you think he might have been in contact with Steele or Nellie Orr or Bruce Orr? Peter's been stroking us. Lisa Page, Mr. Rybicki. Who else was he talking to? But the fact that he could go directly to the general counsel for the FBI, Comey, essentially Comey's right-hand man on issues, on legal issues about the things he was doing at the FBI, he would have known everything. The fact that Sussman had that kind of access and the fact that he could take that information directly to Baker, that's extraordinary. That's absolutely extraordinary. And what's even more extraordinary is it's obviously a very important piece of this puzzle because it's been kept silent up to this point, very, very quiet. Rodenstein didn't say anything about it, and he certainly would have known. Absolutely would have to have known. That's another question for Rodenstein that he's going to have to answer now when he comes to testify, because he would have known all this. Christopher No Shit Sherlock Gray should probably know this. There's a lot of people that knew about this. Peter's been stroking us, Lisa Page. I wonder if any of them, Bruce Orr, I wonder if any of them, Glenn Simpson, all these people would probably know that this was going on. And apparently, they just learned about it. So that means that none of these people have ever said anything. They've kept this very quiet. There's a good reason for that. How about James Comey? Did Comey ever say anything about the fact that his right-hand man, his chief legal counsel, was getting personal information delivered through a lawyer from Perkins Coie who was representing the Rotten Reverend Clinton? Flip this around. What if during the election, the 2016 election, Trump had a lawyer who had direct access to the general counsel, the FBI, the right-hand man to the director, and Trump was feeding them negative information about the Rotten Reverend Clinton? Can you imagine what would happen? So there's a lot of problems here. A lot of problems. And again, it's one thing that this happened. It's another thing. It's been kept quiet for all this time. All this time. And we're just now learning this. And this is a major nugget. And this should have been in the FISA application. This should have been in the FISA application. If they look at the FISA application, those other 20 pages or however many pages there are, and they look at that, and this is not, if the FISA court was not made aware, even though it appears now they didn't even go through the FISA court. It appears that they took another way around it. But if this is not in the FISA warrant application, that they were getting information directly from an attorney who represented the rotten Reverend Clinton and the DNC, and information that was used to get the FISA warrant on Carter Page or any other warrants, national security letters or anything else to conduct surveillance on anyone in the Trump campaign or around the Trump campaign, if there's nowhere in the FISA application where they talk about the fact that this lawyer had direct access to James Comey's right-hand man, the general counsel of the FBI, and that that information was directly pertinent to the FISA application on Carter Page and Trump-Russia information, which probably is now in the hands of Uncle Bob the Executioner. It doesn't pass the sniff test, let's put it that way. It's very, very, very bad. This is very, very bad. Not just that this all happened and it was all kept quiet, but when you look at it in terms of the FISA warrant and everything else, I mean, this is as close as you can get to criminal negligence as you can get. Remember, these people signing the FISA warrants, Rodenstein, Yates, Comey, they're signing that FISA warrant and, you know, in lieu of perjury if they're lying. And there's several ways you can lie. Lies of omission. This would be a lie of omission. If Comey signs a FISA warrant, knowing good and well that he got information from his chief counsel, and that that information originated from a lawyer representing a political candidate who's going after her opponent, and you use that information to go after the opponent, that is corruption at the highest level, and it's blatantly obvious. I mean, there's no defense against this. I don't know how Comey would defend himself here. There's no defense for it. I mean, you can't get caught any more red-handed. I mean, this should put Comey in jail tomorrow morning. We'll see what happens, my friends, but this is incredible, and I can't wait to hear more. I think once the Kavanaugh nomination is over on Saturday, at least once he's confirmed, we know the stuff will keep going, but once he's confirmed, I think there'll be more focus back on the main story we cover here, and I think that this interview with James Baker and what has been learned, I think, is going to have a lot more weight. It's not really making a lot of news today because of everything else going on, but I think next week we might start to see this, a lot of people start looking into this, because this is extraordinary to find out that another attorney other than Mark Elias, a guy actually representing the rotten Reverend Clinton from Perkins Coie, is hand-delivering information to Baker, who's Comey's right-hand man, chief legal counsel. And this stuff all shows up in FISA warrant applications, shows up in the Trump-Russia investigation stuff that Peter's been Stroconis was using, that's now in the hands of Uncle Bob the Executioner. I mean, this is just extraordinary. And, I don't know how people are not being arrested. I don't know how people are not being handcuffed as we're speaking. How Comey's not being hauled away to jail right now as a result of this. So anyway, as I said, none of this appears to have been noted in the FISA application on Carter Page. There's nothing in there apparently saying where they got this information, and that it came that the source of it was an attorney working for Perkins Coie representing the rotten Reverend Clinton. That's the bottom line. And we also know that Sussman was providing not just, you know, verbal communication, not just going over and talking to Baker and saying, yeah, well, you know, I'm hearing this, or we're kind of learning this. No. He was actually providing documents, both standard paper documents as well as electronic media to the FBI. He was essentially a source. He was pushing dossier material. That's what they're talking about when they say Trump-Russia. They're talking about a lot of the same material that showed up in the dossier was being pumped directly into the FBI to Mr. Baker from Mr. Sussman. Okay, we talked about this guy, Jackson Cosco, the guy who was found out to be the person who published the phone numbers of three Republican senators, Hatch, Lee, and Graham. Well, we know that he has been arrested. He was arrested yesterday. That would be Thursday for leaking phone numbers and addresses of Mike Lee, Orrin Hatch, and Lindsey Graham. It appears that Costco had been confronted by a staffer of Democratic Congresswoman Maggie Hassan. Now, after being caught using a computer that he wasn't authorized to use. So he's in this office where he's not supposed to be, using a computer he's not supposed to be on, and he used to work for Hassan. So maybe he got a had her office key or knew how to get access to this room or this office. So he goes in there, and that's the computer he's using to do his dirty work. So then one of her current staffers comes in and confronts him. Hey, buddy, who are you and what are you doing? And apparently, so he runs off. They have this confrontation. Then the staffer apparently contacts the cops. Says, hey, you know, this guy, you know, maybe used to be a staffer here or something. He was unauthorized person. He's in this office using this computer, unauthorized. We don't know what he was doing, but just want to let you know, so I'm making a police report. And so apparently the cops do contact him. And as a result of that, Costco then sends an email to this staffer, who his name, by the way, is Jason Bell. And so this Costco guy sends an email to the staffer and says, hey, if you tell anyone about what I was doing, I will leak it all. Meaning that he would leak info on these senators' children, their health records, and other things, including their Social Security numbers. So he has, of course, been arrested. Certainly charges will be filed. He's looking at like five or, I read the charges yesterday, there's like four or five charges, fairly serious charges. He's looking at a total of as much as 20 years in jail if he's given the full penalty and found guilty on all the charges. So, looks like it didn't take him long to track down that dude. Not as smart as he thought he was, I guess. Well, as many of us have been talking about here, I've been talking about it, many of you in the comments section have been discussing it amongst yourself about how bad this entire thing is going to backfire and will continue to backfire on the Democrats. And now we're getting some polls. There's been two or three, maybe four polls that's come out now. The Marist polls come out. There's been even a Time poll. There's been like four polls. Now Quinnipiac poll have now come out, and they're clearly showing that just in the last 2 weeks, there has been anywhere from a 7 to 12 point swing, 7 to 12 point swing in voter enthusiasm between Republicans and Democrats. Just 2 weeks ago, the Democrats had an edge, a pretty good edge, in voter enthusiasm. Democrats who are more enthusiastic to vote in the upcoming elections than were Republicans. Now that has completely flipped in just 2 weeks since the Kavanaugh debacle. And we are now seeing in poll after poll after poll a 7 to 10 point swing. So now, 2 weeks ago, Democrats were more enthusiastic about voting in the midterms. Now their numbers are dropping. They're becoming less enthusiastic. And Republican enthusiasm for Republicans voting in the midterms is shooting upward, and it continues to do so. And it's not done yet. It could eclipse 15 points, which would be devastating for the Dems. But as most of you have been talking about in the comments section, and as I've mentioned here, it was pretty obvious this thing was going to backfire on them very, very badly. I just don't understand their strategy. I really don't. I just can't understand it. I mean, maybe they have some reason why they think that this is going to help them, but it just doesn't make sense to me. They're doing all this to energize a group of their party, which only makes up about, what, 15-20%? I mean, the real loony, lefty, crazy people of the Democrat Party are probably about 20%, maybe 25. But the overwhelming majority of the people in that party are probably, you know, fairly normal type Democrat people. Many of them in these states in the Rust Belt, in the Midwest, in the South. Places where the Democrats, that's where they need to be effective. These Senate seats that they're looking at, the four or five Senate seats that they could be losing, they're all in places like Missouri, North Dakota, Indiana, West Virginia. You know, those super lunatic crazy lefties don't really reside there. I mean, those people reside on the West Coast, on the East Coast. So from I just cannot understand why they believed that this strategy was going to somehow generate something for them that would help them overall. I mean, it's like instead of going after 75% of their party to get them out to vote by giving them something to vote for, they instead go completely bananas and try to appeal to the 20 or 25%. It just really doesn't make any sense. I mean, there's no real logical reason I can think of that you would employ a strategy like they're employing. But I think they just don't have any choice. I mean, it's Trump derangement syndrome. They're not capable of rational, reasonable, logical thought. It's just they're driven by their complete hatred of Trump and the fact that they have to oppose and resist everything. And I think it's going to result in devastating results for them in the midterms. And I think that they'll get destroyed in 2020 as well. And that's probably the end of the party at that point, as far as this group of Democrats and this particular message. They'll have to completely rebuild the party from the ground up, kick out all the leaders, get all new Democrats. They have to will have to totally change their platform. They'll have to, you know, come way to the center. They'll have to completely go through a complete process, a remaking of the party. It's going to be completely destroyed, and they're on a path of destruction. That has no chance of success whatsoever. But let them continue doing it, right? So, as we suggested, many of us have talked about, yes, what they did in the Kavanaugh hearings has backfired big time, and it's not over. It's not over yet. Still more fallout to come. Now, the True Pundit has got an article today suggesting that the late Senator Magoo, was feeding information to James Baker, and that Baker may have confirmed in his testimony the earlier report that we had months ago that Senator Magoo was feeding names of prominent Russians to Fusion GPS. The names, of course, were given to Magoo by the FBI. Most of the Russians in the Trump Tower meeting were on that list of the problematic Russians, including Veselnitskaya. So if you remember the original story we got a couple months ago, and of course, you know, Veselnitskaya made a visit to Senator Magoo's office. We know that she took a photo from his office, and we know that there was a donation made from his foundation to an organization that she's affiliated with, okay? But we learned that Senator Magoo had come upon a list of these problematic Russians that were being watched, or Russians that we were looking at. And somehow this list of problematic Russians found its way to Confusion GPS. And then those Russians who had associations with Confusion GPS end up in the Trump Tower meeting. Most of them were on that list. Now it appears from something they learned from James Baker that either he was the one providing those names, or he knows who was providing those names to Senator Magoo so that he could pass them along to Veselnitskaya, who, remember, had to be granted a special visa to get into the country. There's a lot more to learn about Senator Magoo and this whole scam that was being run here. We all know that whole thing was a setup anyway. We also have learned today that the man who mailed the ricin to Secretary of Defense Mattis, he has now been arrested in Utah. His name is William Clyde Allen III. And apparently he was attempting to mail some ricin to President Trump as well. Well, like I say, you can expect over the next 3 weeks up until the midterm election, the next 3.5 weeks or so, after Kavanaugh is confirmed, don't expect the Democrats to back off or to say, oh, well, I guess we lost, let's move on and start talking about actual issues. No. That's not going to happen. The Democrats are going to continue to ride this horse all the way into the midterms because they must think it's a winner So Kavanaugh will be confirmed almost certainly, and they'll from that time up until the midterms, they'll just continue to stay on that game, and they won't get off of it. I can assure you that it's going to be quite humorous, quite entertaining. In the meantime, hopefully we'll get some more good information about what came out of the interview with Mr. Baker. I think there's a lot to learn there, and should be pretty cool to find out what we learned there.